thank you for this time that we get to come together as brothers and sisters, not just in this church, but around the world, to proclaim and praise your name. We love you and we thank you, and we just ask that the Holy Spirit be here and move in a mighty, powerful way. Open our hearts and open our minds so that we can see and hear more about you. We love you and we thank you. In your Son's name we pray. Amen. Let's welcome one another as they continue to pray. See, Brad, is the sign-up sheet still right here, Weston? It is right here. So if you can help out with the attendance, five to ten more people can help out. Okay? Is there anything else on announcements? I'm just trying to remember. Some people told me different things before I got up here, and I can't remember anything. So just, I did forget about that. Men's breakfast is next Sunday, still at 7:30? Still at 7:30. And WOM does not meet tomorrow, but it meets, WOM meets next Monday. What is that day? Six. Thank you. The 6th at 6 p.m. here in the fellowship hall. Is that everything for announcements, I think? I'll get that out. I will get that out on that. So, but we are going to be doing Christmas caroling with the kids and the youth, so be paying attention to that. And I will get that information out to you today. As we come to our time of prayer. I don't know about you. I was talking to Wesley just a minute ago, and he goes, I thought holidays were supposed to get slower and easier. Anybody feel like they've been beat up over the past week? It does happen, and I don't know about you, but I have been going through it, so I wanted to read two verses to you. I feel like I forgot who I told this morning, but I feel like I've been 15 rounds with the devil this week. And it gets to be a little tough sometimes, but I want to remind us of this great news right here out of 2 Corinthians 5, as we approach our time of prayer. Paul says in verse 20, now then, we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God were pleading through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. And right here it is, verse 21. For he made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. That's some good news today. And I don't know about you, but when we take and look at the deal, there's no better deal in all of the universe. Jesus Christ takes all of our sin, past, present, and future. He took it on the cross. And what do we get in return? We get the righteousness of God. That is a great deal. And if you're going through it, like I know, brothers and sisters, like I have been through this week, I just ask you just to remember the plain and simple fact. In those darkest, those tough moments, we have the righteousness of God. He gives us his full righteousness. So as we come to our time of prayer, I want to mention a couple that have been brought up to me. Obviously, Steve started not feeling very well this morning, so he's not here, so continue to pray for him. He is at home, and I don't know what he's going to do. He doesn't have Sheila there to help him out right now. So Sheila, we're going to try to get you home to Steve very quick. So we're going to get her there, Steve. But continue to pray for Steve. Also, obviously, continue to pray for Miss Ruby. Just in case you did not hear, she actually, Wednesday morning early, she did have 4 strokes. She does have movement on her right side again. Things are getting better. She came home Thanksgiving afternoon. But continue to pray for Ruby and Gary and just the whole family. Just be in prayer for all of them. And that is on the prayer list. A couple more that were mentioned to me. Tony Meadows, he does have cancer. I know there's been prayer requested for him. And Everett told me this morning, if you would be in prayer for him, his cancer is coming back. So we need to be in prayer for Everett and Pat, just be in prayer for both of them. And during this time, as Karen begins to play, we'll ask you to stand. There are plenty of things that we can pray for. And I ask together today that we come up here, wherever you are, let's pray together. We pray for these that are mentioned. If you have something that hasn't been mentioned, it's not on the prayer list, let me know. But let's utilize this altar this morning. Let's just get prepared to worship the Lord our God right now. Every step. You've been there. You're true and faithful, full of mercy and grace, and are just willing to pour out that mercy and grace and your wisdom upon us. And Father, we just want to praise you and thank you for that cross of Jesus Christ, for that blood that covers our sins. And Father, we just praise you that as we walk through the good and the bad and all the things, we just praise and honor you that you're walking with us, that your presence is there with us each and every step of the way, and you have not forsaken us, and we are not alone today, Father. And you are God that's worthy of all the praise and honor, and we just want to lift you up and honor you today. Father, we pray for those that are on the prayer list today. Father, there are so many, and the list gets longer and longer and longer, and I know we all have some that are unspoken in our hearts. We just lift them up, and we just place them at the foot of the cross. We place them in your hands, Father. There's no better or safer place to be than in your hands. And we just ask for your peace and your comfort, your guidance, your wisdom, your strength. But Father, most of all, we pray in each and every one of these situations that those that are going through the valley right now, we just ask that you remind them that they are loved by the God of the universe. You lift them up. And Father, we just pray that in all things that you get the honor and the glory that only you deserve. Father, we pray for brothers and sisters around the world today as we prepare our hearts to hear your word and then go out into the world and just live it out so the world can see your glory. Father, I just pray for that boldness. I pray for that strength and that guidance. I pray for the words to speak. And Father, I just pray that you open hearts and open minds, prepare the way before we go so that the world, those that are out there walking without your son, Jesus Christ, that they can see how wonderful of a God that you are and how much you love them. And if there's ever any question about how much you love each and every one of us, just all we have to do is look at the cross of Jesus Christ. And Father, I just pray that you open hearts and open minds. Father, I just pray that you speak through me this morning. Father, I pray for open hearts and open minds so that we can hear and see wonderful things from your word. And Father, I pray for our country. I pray for the world and leaders. Father, we just want in all things, in us and around the world, for you to get the honor and the glory that only you deserve. We love you and we thank you and we praise and honor you. And it's in Jesus' precious and holy name that we pray. Amen. Please remain standing.
We're going to take our rhythm and we're going to turn to hymn number 228. First, take it. Sing you on this story while we sing the fire. Y'all come on up.
Thank you.
missing one of the books, but it wasn't, so we had to make some copies. Please sing along with us. This is right after Thanksgiving. I'm blessed with no truer words. So sing along with us if you know the song.
I'm saying at least six, probably, yeah.
Okay, at least six or so. So if you can help with the guardian angels during the nativity, that's what, 2 weeks away? Less than 2 weeks now, so yesterday? Sign up, he will put that up here. You got my podium? Lapel mic on. Yeah, there we go. That way if I get moving around, y'all can hear me. All right. 1 Samuel 21 and 22, and y'all are going, oh Lord, we're going to be here all day again. I promise I'm going to do a summary of chapters 18 through 22, but my main text is coming out of 21 and 22 today. And last week, what I did, I started talking to you last week about David and Goliath. And I asked the question last week, what does a man or woman after God's own heart, what does a man or a woman after God's own heart look like? And the answer was simple and straightforward. A man or woman after God's own heart, they depend on God, they trust in the Lord, and they place their hope in the Lord. That's what set David and King Saul apart, was that right there. And see, when Goliath taunted and defied the armies of God, David was not scared like Saul and rest of the Israelites. David, and I want you to get this in your head, I said it last week, I'm going to say it again. David wasn't scared. David was offended. What would happen today if the church got offended because of God's glory was being defiled in the world? Be a big change, game changer. And David trusted, he placed his hope in, he depended on God. David joined God where God was already working. See, David didn't try to make up some new place that, or some new thing or some new program or some new scheme. David saw where God was already working and he went and joined him. That's our cue. When we see God working, that's God's big neon sign. How many people would love to see that big neon sign that says, I want you to work right here, Terry. I want you to work right here, Scott. How many of us want to see that big neon sign? When God opens your eyes and your hearts to see where he's working, that's his invitation to join him where he's already at work. We don't need to come up with new stuff. God's already working. And David, in the story of David and Goliath, he was focused on one thing. It wasn't Goliath. It wasn't the Philistine army. It wasn't King Saul or the Israelites that were standing around being scared for 40 days and nights. David was focused on one thing. David was focused on God and his glory and his name being known in this world. That's what we're here for today. And that's what the world is about. And like I said, today I've got a lot of ground to uncover, to cover, but it's important, and it's important that I cover all this ground so that we can understand and see what leads up to chapter 21 and 22. In 1 Samuel 18 through 23, we're going to cover about a 7-year period of history. David was a teenager, and it goes up to about the point here where David's about 22, 23 years old. So we cover a 7-year period of history. And I want to start off, before I even dive in, I want to start off making this comment. And I want you to hear me and listen to me closely and see if this is not true in your own life. Sometimes we do some of the dumbest and most foolish things when we're angry, when we're lonely, or when we're afraid. Can I get an amen on that?
Amen.
Sometimes, listen, this is what I want us to really hear today, because I'll get to these questions at the end today. Sometimes we even consider things that we would never do because of anger, because of loneliness, because we are afraid. These three things, these three giants, they have the potential to undermine the most devout, and disciplined person there is walking with Christ. They have the potential to crash through every moral and ethical boundary that is set. They have the potential to drive us right through the guardrail and straight off a cliff. If we're honest with ourselves and we look back over our life in the past, one of these three things, anger, loneliness, or fear, one of these three things, or most likely a combination of these three things, are part of one of our greatest regrets. Is that not true? And let me tell you something. One of these three things, or a combination of all three of these things, or two of them, will be part of a future regret that we will probably have at some point too. Anger, loneliness, and fear. And why? Why are these always part of some of our biggest regrets? When one or more of these three things build up inside of us, we are overwhelmed by anger. We're overwhelmed by loneliness and fear and the emotions that are associated with it. We feel compelled to do something. In other words, you ready for this? We panic. And why do we panic? Why do we have to do something? You ready for this? Because we are losing control See, we're people that like to be in control of things. And so many times, even as Christians, myself at times too, all of us, we always forget the fact that God is sovereign and God is in control of his whole universe. And we try to take matters into our own hands. And what will happen is, we will do just about anything to regain control, to relieve that tension that comes from the anxiety, that comes from anger, loneliness, and fear. And what happens is, we usually get impatient, and we do the wrong thing. And as a result, this is what happens. We're full of anxiety, so we go out and we try to control the situation. And when we do this and take matters in our own hands, we don't get less anxiety. We get more anxiety. There's not less regret. There's more regret. There's no peace or clarity, but there's more chaos and confusion. And we end up angrier, lonelier, and more afraid than when we started. Anybody ever been there before? This is what we do to ourselves. Because we forget about the promises of God, we forget about the provision of God, and we forget about the presence of God in our lives. This is what we do to ourselves. This is what happened to Saul and David too. And as we go through the story today, I want you to take note of Saul. But my whole point, my whole focus today is going to be on David. It is on David. And we all know David had two great, colossal failures in his life. One of them is well known. One is when David committed adultery and then sent Uriah and other men to the worst part of the battle to cover up his own adultery, and they were killed. This happened when David was in his 50s. The second colossal failure is what we're going to talk about today, and people really don't think about this one, but it goes along with anger, loneliness, and fear, and it was one of David's greatest colossal failures. And this happened when David was in his early 20s. So what I'm going to do today is very simple. I'm going to give you a quick summary, as quick as I can, so I don't want to hear a word stop. As quick as I can, on 18, 19, 20, 21, and 22 to get to my points today. But I want you to hear, and I need you to hear the story of what anger, loneliness, being abandoned, being afraid did to Saul. And I want you to hear what it did to David that would end up being the future king of Israel. A man that is after God's own heart. And I want you to find comfort and encouragement in it today. Because if you see yourself in David's shoes doing these things, the good news is David was still king. God had a purpose for him. And I just want to say this right from the very start. If you see yourself in this story today, which I think all of us should, I want you to be encouraged because God still wants to use you today. So, here we go. After the story of David and Goliath in chapter 17, David became the most famous and the most popular person in Israel, and he was not even the most popular in Israel. He was well known by the Philistines because he killed their champion. They were writing that, listen, they were literally, the women were writing and singing songs about David. And Saul realizes something. King Saul realizes, this David, he has a lot of potential. He has a lot of influence and a lot of power. How do you think Saul responded? Saul was very, very insecure. He was afraid and jealous, which led to anger towards David. So Saul comes up with this beautiful, wonderful, masterful plan in his own head. Well, David is this powerful, influential person. So, I'm going to get David in my family. I'm going to offer him my oldest daughter, and he can marry, and I can have David in my family. See, the move was political and a military move for Saul. He was trying to maneuver because he was afraid of David, and he was jealous. So he comes up with this, and he offers David his oldest daughter in marriage. And David's response in chapter 18, verse 18, is pretty simple. David looks at the king, and he says, "Who am I? Who am I, king? Who is my family? Who am I? We are not worthy. I am not worthy to be the king's son-in-law. We're just a bunch of nobodies. And Saul, so he rejects the proposal of Saul. Saul doesn't give up. He keeps on, and he keeps on a few more times. And eventually what happens is David doesn't marry the older daughter. David falls in love with a younger daughter, King Saul's, named Michal. And he ends up marrying the younger daughter, Michal. And then, not only that, David and Jonathan, the king's son, the next in line to be the king, they become as close as two people can in a friendship. So we've got Jonathan, this king's son, and we got Michal, the king's daughter, youngest daughter, are now with David. What happens is this. Saul eventually realizes that his great plan to get David to be part of his family was about the dumbest thing he could ever do. He realizes that it was a bad idea, and Saul gets more jealous, more insecure, all because everybody loves David. And for about a 7-year period, what you see here is David falls out of favor, David's in favor, David's out of favor, David's in favor for about a 7-year period with King Saul. It's a love-hate relationship. And what happens is that Saul's like, I got to get rid of this guy. I got to get rid of David. I got to kill him. But I can't kill him. Everybody loves him. I can't kill him. So Saul's next great plan was very simple. Instead of me killing David, I'm going to let the Philistines do it. So any chance that Saul could get to send David to the front line, to the worst battle, Saul sends David out there in hopes that David's going to get killed in battle. And what happens? Every time, David returns right back. You see how foolish Saul is acting over anger, over loneliness, and over being afraid? David always came back. And what happened eventually happened is it escalated to a point that Saul had enough. And Saul discovers, that every time that he hatches a new plan, you ready for this? His own family, his own daughter, Michal, David's wife, his own son that's next to be king, Jonathan, every time that he has a plan, guess who goes tells David? His wife and his son. Finally, it all culminates one night at dinner. Now, the dinner with the king and the evening was very, very prestigious. It was a big deal, and if you were to sit at the king's table, it was a great honor. And one night, David is not at the table. And Saul looks over to his son, and he goes, "Where's David?" And he's mad. Jonathan had been covering for him different times when David hadn't been there. And Saul, he explodes. His anger gets the best of him. And I want you to listen to chapter 20, verse 30 real quick. Then Saul's anger was aroused against Jonathan, and he said to him, pause a second. This is one of those verses I wish was not in the Bible for little kids to hear. Listen to it right here. Saul's anger was aroused against Jonathan, and he said to him, "You son of a perverse, rebellious woman, do I not know that you have chosen the son of Jesse to your own shame and to the shame of your mother's nakedness?" Hold a second. I really hope this wife isn't in there with him. What do y'all think? This obviously is not one of his favorite wives. Saul's just lost it. He has completely lost it right here. And it culminates here. And he's just angry. And he tells him, "Look, you, Jonathan, you, Michal, everyone sitting at this table, you all know what's going on. You sided with him. Jonathan, are you serious? You sided with the one that's going to take your spot as king. And as long as the son of Jesse is still alive, you will never be the king." Jonathan loves David. Michal loves David. tell you something. Throw back, rewind to the start of 1 Samuel. King Saul has been rejected by God. He's been rejected. Samuel the prophet's even told King Saul, look, you're not going to be the king. God has rejected you. Saul knows this. And he's still trying to do everything he can. Not to fight against David, but to fight against God. That's what Saul is doing. Saul is defying God. And sometimes, even when we know, when we've been told, don't we do the same thing? Don't we try to fight against God even though we know we shouldn't sometimes? We all do it. That's what's going on here. And you see how foolish Saul is acting. So, Saul's like, bring David to me. He does one of those, and don't look at your wife or your husband or your kid and teenage daughter or son. Does this. He does one of those, bring David to me, I'm going to kill him. And stomps off. And he exits the room. So you know what Jonathan does? Jonathan goes and he finds David and he tells David, look, you got to leave, David. I love you, brother. You got to leave. My daddy is trying to kill you, and he is not going to rest until he kills you. David, you got to go. At this time, David is around 22, 23 years old. And David leaves. He's afraid for his life. He's getting ready to feel completely and totally isolated and abandoned from the world. Anger and resentment is going to build up in him. Because remember, if you remember about 7, 8 years ago, Samuel the prophet comes to Jesse and the family of David and anoints David to be the next king. And the resentment and the anger is going to build up because he's like, God, you promised me this. What's wrong? You told me this was going to happen. And it's going to build up. And it's going to happen. And David is going to act very foolish for the next few chapters right here. And what David did, David panicked. He is to be the next king. He's been provided for. He had God's presence with him. He panics. He takes matters into his own hands. He loses sight of the fact of God's presence in his life. He loses sight of the fact of God's promise to be the next king of Israel. He loses sight. You ready for this? He loses sight of the provision and the protection that God had provided to him just 7 years previously. David and Goliath. Now what we can do is we can look at this story, this part of the story, and we can take a 30,000 foot airplane view looking down on it, and we can ask the question, why would you do this, David? Why would you panic? Why would you run away, David? And it's easy. From 30,000 foot feet, it's easier 3,000 years later to look at the story of David and go, how foolish this is when we see what he does next here just a little bit. It's easy to see that from 30,000 feet. It really is. And you may be in a place yourself that somebody in this room or somebody in your family is looking at you going, how foolish. Why have they, listen teenagers, why have they turned to that boyfriend or that girlfriend that they shouldn't have and their parents don't like and you know that and they're just doing it out of spite? Why have they turned to that affair? Something that they would never consider before. Why would they turn to buying all that stuff that they don't need? Why would they turn to the drugs or the bottle that they spent months and years getting off of, and thousands of dollars going through rehab? You see, when we start to do crazy things, we act just like David, and we start to consider and do things that we would never consider and do in the first place. All of this, it leads to regret. Is there anybody in here that has regret today from things that they've done in the past? Saul didn't realize what he was doing. David didn't realize it. And so David flees. And listen to this. This is where David flees to in chapter 21, verses 1 through 9. Now David came to Nob, to Ahimelech, the priest. And Ahimelech was afraid when he met David and said to him, why are you alone and no one is with you? Now pause just a second there after verse 1. So David, Jonathan tells him, leave. He ends up leaving. He goes to Nob, and the chief priest of Ahimelech is there. Now, what's going on is very simple. At this time in the history of Israel, they do not have a centralized place of worship. They don't have the temple in Jerusalem. So the place of worship is wherever the ark is. And the ark is usually in the safest city at this time. And since the city of Nob has the Ark of the Covenant in it, guess where the priests are? The priests are here in Nob, and Ahimelech is the chief priest. So David comes, and he's coming. Now let me remind you, David travels as the champion of Israel, well-known, captain of the guard. David travels with 1,000 men. Word gets out in front of David, hey, David is coming. And here he shows up to the chief priest alone. I don't know about you, but if I was this chief priest, I'd be scratching my head and wondering what's going on. And that's exactly what Ahimelech is doing. So David said to Ahimelech the priest, the king has ordered me on some business and said to me, do not let anyone know about the business on which I send you or what I have commanded you. And I have directed my young men to such and such place. Pause. So David's alone. He's scared. He's getting angry. He's having that resentment. He flees from the promise of God to be there, to be the next king. And he flees and he goes to the city of Nob. And what does David do? He shows up alone. The priest knows something is wrong. And what does David do? He lies. Hey, the king sent me on a mission. Oh, I can't tell you, priest. Can't do it. Well, where are your men at, David? Oh, they're out here waiting on me in a place I told them to wait. The men don't even know about it, though. He's just lying. He is lying. Anybody ever been scared? Anybody ever been alone? Anybody ever have fear and anger and they've lied? That's what David does right here. He answers with a lie. Let me tell you something about that lie. This lie would cost David, not just David, it would cost Ahimelech and 85 priests and Ahimelech's whole family and the whole city, the whole village of Nob. It would cost them all their lives except for one person. David's lie here, this colossal failure, is going to cost so many people. Let me continue reading right here in chapter 21, verse 3. Now therefore, what have you on hand? Give me 5 loaves of bread in my hand or whatever can be found. And the priest, Ahimelech, answered David and said, there is no common bread on hand, but there is holy bread, if the young men have at least kept themselves from women. Then David answered the priest and said to him, truly women have been kept from us about 3 days since I came out. And the vessels of the young men are holy, and the bread is in effect common, even though it was consecrated in the vessel this day. So the priest gave him holy bread. For there was no bread. And I'll pick up there in verse 6 here in just a second. Let me tell you what's going on. Now a lot of us go, what in the world is going on with this bread? Just give him the bread, let the guy eat, right? Well, back then, what happened was on the altar, they would place the priest every Sabbath day. The chief priest would bake bread, consecrated bread, for the Lord. They'd place it on the altar, and when they woke up, and this is part of it, this is normal. So don't think this is like really weird. This was normal back then. When they woke up and they saw that the Lord had not eaten the bread, it was bread that was reserved and left over for the priest to eat. This is what the priests were to eat. So there's no common bread on hand. It's only consecrated holy bread. And when the Lord hadn't eaten it, which obviously the Lord never ate it, it was supplied, it was provisions for the priest. And so David's like, I'll take it. It's offered to me, I'll take it. And that's what happens right here. So the priest gave him the holy bread, for there was none. But the showbread which had been taken from before the Lord in order to put hot bread in its place on the day when it was taken. Now listen to verse 7 here to the end. Now a certain man of the servants of Saul, So there's a guy there from Saul's own, out of his servants. He was actually the chief herdsman. Was there that day. And his name was Doeg, an Edomite, the chief of the herdsmen who belonged to Saul. And David said to Ahimelech, "Is there not here on hand a spear or a sword? For I have brought neither my sword nor weapons with me, because the king's business required haste." Pause a second. All right. David shows up. He's on a secret mission, has none of his men with him. He has no food, has no provision, has no sword, has no armor. Would you not start scratching your head trying to figure out what's going on here with David? Something's going on. And he comes and he says, "Look, I don't even have a weapon. Now, the mission is so urgent. I just have to pick up and leave. Do you have any weapon that I can use, Ahimelech?" Listen to this. Verse 9. So the priest said, "The sword of Goliath, the Philistine, whom you killed, David, in the valley of Elah. There it is, wrapped in a cloth behind the ephod. If you will take that, take it. For there is no other except that one." And David said, "There is none like it. Give it to me." But let me give you an idea of what's going on here. We've got this 7-year period here. David starts off, and he, chapter 17, he stood in where nobody else would stand in for Israel. He stood up and defended the name and the glory of God. Within 7 years, here he is lying and doing all this stuff. And right here, in front of him, pops up this reminder of David's initial great victory that the Lord gave him. You see, this should have been the point when David goes, "What am I doing? Why am I running from what God has already... Why am I doing all this? Why am I lying to the chief priest? Why am I doing all this stuff? Why am I acting so foolish?" This should have been the point that David, his eyes were open, remembering that when the Lord gave him the victory over Goliath. See, what would happen is David, after the victory over Goliath, David took the sword, cut off Goliath's head, and he kept it as a souvenir. I don't know about you, but if I beat this 9-foot-6-inch giant, I want a souvenir of my victory. But what David did, he kept it for a while, then he handed it off and consecrated it and gave it to the priest. And what David, in effect, was doing was saying very simple, "Lord, it was not because of me that I had the victory over Goliath. It was because of you. It's because I depended on you. I trusted in you, and I placed my hope in you, Lord." Eyes should have been open. Pause a second. How many times when you look back, when you've acted in fear, when you've acted in anger, when you've acted out of loneliness, and you have those regrets, when you look back, do you see a moment where you should go, "My eyes should have been open. I should have seen it"? Hindsight's 20/20, right? This was David's wake-up call. And you know what David said? Right there in verse 9, he goes, "Oh yeah, I remember now who God is. I remember what he promised. I remember what he has done. I remember how, I see how foolish I'm being." No. David takes the sword. In other words, literally, David takes matters into his own hands. He's lied and he takes matters into his own hands. And the question is, what does David do next? Verse 10 right there. Now I want you to catch this. "Then David arose and fled that day from before Saul and went to Achish, the king of Gath." Okay. David's scared. He's afraid. He's alone. He's getting resentment and anger. And you know what David's brilliant plan is? "I'm going to go to the king of Gath. I'm going to go to the Philistines. I'm going to hide out with the Philistines. Oh, and the city I'm going to go to the city of Gath.
Who else is from the city of Gath? Goliath. Really, David? You're going to go to the Philistines. You're going to go to the city of Gath, where Goliath is from, and you're carrying his sword. You want to go do that? That's pretty foolish to me. He's scared. He's alone. His anger and resentment is building up, and he does the most foolish thing you could think of. He goes to the Philistines, to the city of Gath, where Goliath is from, with the sword of Goliath. That's what David's brilliant plan is. And he goes. See, right here, when he saw the sword of Goliath, he should have been reminded in his head, and he should have remembered the victory that he had when he depended on God, when he trusted him and placed his hope in God. You see, 3,000 years later, 30,000 feet up in the air, looking down on this story, we can see in other people their weaknesses and the things that they're blind to. But the sad part is, when it comes to our blind spots, they're called blind spots for a reason. We can't see how foolish we're acting when we're in the middle of the situation. See, for David, it was easy to depend on. It was easy to trust and place his hope in God when things are easy. It's easy for us to do the same things when things are going good and we're comfortable. It's easy to place our trust in Jesus Christ. But let the heat get turned up. Let God promise something that seems so crazy, that's just out there, something that just doesn't make any sense. That's when things get real with our faith. That's when you have to get out of bed each and every morning swinging. That's when we have to battle. And boy, it's a battle. And I know it's just myself and some of you that talked to me already this morning. We've been through the battle this past week. Some of us just this morning. See, it's easy to show up. It's easy to praise God. It's easy to read Scripture and learn about God. It's easy to pray when things are easy. But when the things that we start to value and love start to fade away, that's when faith gets real. And that's what's happened right here with David. Man after God's own heart, the next king of Israel. The heat gets turned up and he panics. He takes matters into his own hands. And fear, anger, and loneliness make David not just consider things he would never consider before, but he does things that he would never, ever do. So he's run to the Philistines. And when he gets there to the king, he approaches them. And the people around, the servants around the king, they're looking, they're going, isn't this the David? Isn't this the one that they were writing songs about in chapter 18? So David's even more scared. And David starts acting like he's mad, crazy, needs to be put in an insane asylum. He starts drooling at the mouth. And the king's looking at him going, we got enough crazy people here. We don't need them. And they send him away. And you know where David ends up? He ends up in a cave. Isolated. Afraid. Angry. That's where David ends up. He flees to a cave and he doesn't know what to do. Finally, what David ends up doing in chapter 22, he seeks a prophet of the Lord, and his name is Gad. And he says to this prophet, look, I've really messed up. I want to know what God's will is. Will you seek the Lord on my behalf and ask him what he wants me to do? And Gad does so. And you know what Gad tells him to do? This is ironic. This is funny. David was promised to be the next king. He is from a town of Bethlehem in Judah. And Gad, the Lord tells Gad to tell David, go back to Judah. Go back to where you all started. You should have never run in the first place, David. And so he returns to the land of Judah. Now, this is what I want you to hear today. Here's the problem. Here's what happens with David's colossal failure right here. The damage was already done. See, David had already gone to the city of Nob. He had already inquired of the chief priest, Ahimelech, there in Nob. But there was a man there named Doeg, the servant of the king in charge of his herds. And so Doeg, while he was in, David was in Nob, saw David, and guess what Doeg does? He runs and tattles on David. Hey, king, I know where David is. You're seeking him. You want to kill him. Here he is. He went to the city of Nob, and he inquired of the priest, the chief priest. 7-year period here. Michal, Saul's daughter, marries David. Jonathan, next to be king, best friends with David. David flees. Everybody in Saul's court is helping out David. David flees. He goes to the chief priest, and now the chief priest helps David. Do you think Saul might get a picture here? He doesn't, of course. Saul is angry. Saul is really, really angry. And so he calls Ahimelech and his family and the priest, and he says, hey, look, my son, my daughter, even my chief priest, you all have fed, equipped, and helped my enemy David. And Ahimelech responds there in verses 14 through 15 to King Saul in chapter 22. He says, look, David's been your faithful servant the whole time. He's done nothing against you, king. Why are you seeking his life? And listen to verses 20, chapter 22, verses 16 through 19 right here. And the king, Saul, said to Ahimelech, you shall surely die, you and all your father's house. And the king said to the guards who stood about him, turn and kill the priests of the Lord, because their hand also is with David, and because they knew when he fled and did not tell it to them. But the servants of the king would not lift their hands to strike the priests of the Lord. Pause a second. So he's got Ahimelech and all the priests there in front of him, and King Saul, angry, afraid, he looks at his guards and he says, kill the priests. And the priests look at the king and they go, we'll kill anybody. Your enemies, we'll kill your best friend, but we're not going to touch the priest. So they don't touch the priest. The guards will not kill the priest. So here we go. Verse 18. And the king said to the tattletale, Doeg, you turn and kill the priest. So Doeg, the Edomite, turned and struck the priest and killed on that day 85 men who wore a linen ephod. Also, verse 19, Nob, the city of priests, he struck with the edge of the sword both men and women, children, nursing infants, oxen and donkeys and sheep with the edge of the sword. David's life, the damage was already done. Ahimelech, dead. His family, dead. 85 priests, dead. The city of Nob, destroyed. However, one of Ahimelech's sons did escape. And he runs to tell David in verse 20 through 22. Now, one of the sons of Ahimelech, the son of Abitu, named Abathar, escaped and fled after David. And Abathar told David that Saul had killed the Lord's priest. So David, listen to this. So David said to Abathar, I knew that day when Doeg the Edomite was there that he would surely tell Saul. I caused the death of all the persons in your father's house. You see, the sword of Goliath should have been the wake-up call. But instead, all these men, all these priests, the family, the whole city, village of Nob, destroyed. The wake-up call was too late. The damage had already been done. All because David, he was afraid. He was had anger and resentment, and he was alone. And he panicked, and he took matters into his own hands, and he didn't remember what happened just 7 years before. Sometimes, I know that's a quick summary, but I want to get to my questions to you real quick. Sometimes, taking matters into our own hands, it feels good. It feels like we're in control. But taking matters into our own hands never turns out for the best. It never does. Now, I want to ask, as I begin to close up right here with this story, this is where the heart of my message is today, because I want to make this personal for you and me. I want us to see how we act like David and Saul at times. But I want to ask four questions this morning. There are times our anger, isolation, and fear push us to do things and consider things we know we shouldn't and that we know that we would never consider in the first place. So question number one is this. Very simple. What is your loneliness, your anger, or your fear causing you to consider that you had never considered before? What is your loneliness, anger, or fear causing you to consider that you have never considered before? Or maybe now, something that you considered and you've already done, and now you regret. Relationally, financially, physically, emotionally, habits you spent money and time trying to break for months and for years. What are some things right now that you would never consider morally or ethically, but because you are afraid, because you are lonely, because you are angry at someone or something else? What things are you considering that you would never consider before? Question number two. What is your loneliness, your anger, or your fear causing you to consider that you know you shouldn't consider or have already let yourself or already let in that you know you shouldn't? Let me explain this to you. What are you considering that you would never let into your life that you're really considering it now? Teenagers, I've already said this. You know what the Lord says about it. Young people, you know what the Lord says about it. What about that boy or girl? That boy or girl that you would want to date, that you know would drive your parents crazy. I hear a couple laughs because some people probably did that before. We won't call any names, Stephanie. What about a toxic person that you know would draw you away from God, your family, and your friends? Listen, this question right here, this is why many women return to abusive husbands, because of fear and loneliness. They cause you to do things that and let people and things in that you would never let in if you were in your right state of mind. Because whatever is happening in your life, this person that was never an option before is now an option. Or this person that you're considering to let back into your life, that you removed from your life because they were a toxic person, you're now considering letting them back in. And I'm not talking about forgiveness here. We're called to forgive all people no matter what. But sometimes, in certain situations, from being abused or sexually assaulted, sometimes forgiveness needs to happen from a distance, amen? I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about considering and allowing things or people into your life that you know are going to draw you away from God that are toxic. Number three, this is the wake-up call question. Number three, who besides you do your considerations put at risk? Who besides you do your considerations put at risk? David. 85 priests, Ahimelech, the whole village of Nob. Is it your spouse? That affair that you're thinking about, or that stuff that you're looking at online? Your family, your children, your friends, your co-workers? When you take that next drink and you get behind the wheel, the people on the road? Here's the big one. Who besides you do your considerations put at risk? Here's the big one. When you're doing these things and the things you consider that you would have never considered before, is it putting your witness and your record and God's reputation and His glory and His name at stake to where they won't know how great of a God that He is? You see, these options that were not options before, but now are, who else do they put at risk? I can tell you that answer very quickly. It's usually the people that you love the most and the people that love you the most that they put at risk. And all of us here today, we can witness to that and we can say amen from personal experience. The people that hurt us the most are the ones that we love the most, and those are the ones that you are putting at risk when you are considering and doing things that you would never consider because of anger, loneliness, and fear. Who else are you putting at risk with what you're considering because of this? Who else's future hangs in the balance because of what you're considering? Who will be affected by considering and giving in to your anger, your isolation, and your fear? And number four, this is where it gets real for us. This is a huge question. What advice would you give to someone? What advice would you give to someone that has been in your, that is in your shoes? What advice would you give to yourself if you are looking from 30,000 foot down in your own situation right now? What advice would you give to yourself? You see, we're really, really, really good about standing back and pointing out the weaknesses and the foolish things that our brothers and sisters are doing. But when it comes to our weaknesses and our foolishness, we're pretty blind. And that's why I want to say this right here. There are people out there all the time that say, I can be a good Christian without being around brothers and sisters and coming to church. You're just lying and deceiving yourself. You need brothers and sisters that love and care for you, love you enough to hold you accountable when you're considering or doing foolish things because of fear, because of anger, because of loneliness. What advice would you tell others? And would you listen to yourself if that advice would be is being told to you? The advice David would give us. And remember, David wasn't just a king. He was also a poet. And he wrote many of the Psalms. And I want you to listen to just a small sampling of David's advice to us today. I want you to hear his advice from a man that has been there, done that, and just prays and hopes that you will never go through the things that he's gone through. Here's David's advice. Psalm 9:9. Lord is a refuge for the oppressed. Psalm 1:2. Blessed are those who delight in the Lord and his ways. Psalm 3:3. You, Lord, are a shield for me. Psalm 4:8. You, Lord, make me dwell in safety. Psalm 5:11. I take refuge in the Lord. Psalm 18:1, you are my strength. Psalm 19:14, you are my rock and my redeemer. Psalm 23, you are my shepherd. Psalm 25, I, Lord, put my trust in you. The verses that we covered last week, I put my trust in you. Teach me, guide me, lead me. You are my salvation. Listen, this is David's advice, the king, telling us today. When you start considering things that you would never consider because you are angry, because you are lonely, or because you're afraid, here is David's advice. Trust in the Lord. Depend on Him. Place your hope in Him. And as I close up, I want you to hear this. All this stuff that leads to regret. David, this one decision would affect the rest of his life, including while he was king. And maybe you're sitting here going, yeah, Pastor, it's a little too late. I've already got that regret. I've already got that shame. Is there anybody here that doesn't have regret and shame from something they've done in the past before? Anybody? Because if you don't have any regret, I want to know how you have it. Maybe you're sitting here going, too late, already done it, messed up. That I was considering, I've already crossed the line and done it. We look around today. We walk into the world, Christian, non-Christian. We walk out there today, we look around and hear every one of us have messed up in that way at some point. We have done and acted some way foolishly because we were angry, because we were lonely, because we were afraid. Let me tell you some good news today. And I say this, and I can't stop saying this enough. Jesus Christ knew what he was buying on the cross. There's no return policy on you. He has to keep you, and he loves it. All that shame, all that guilt, all that regret that you have because you have already crossed the line, there's good news that his blood covers every bit of it. Where sin abounds, grace abounds much more. Listen, I want us to see, not that we are David, but sometimes we act just like David. When we get afraid, when we get angry at somebody, when we just feel like we're all alone and nobody cares for us and not even God loves us, we do some dumb and foolish things. And when we do that, we end up with regret and shame. We saw that come in Genesis chapter 3 with the man and woman. But you know something? Jesus overcame all of that, and his blood covers everything. And we can walk out these doors today, whether you are a believer and have Jesus Christ and you still have regret, or whether you have never come to Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. We can come today and we can walk out those doors, and all that regret and all that can be pushed out back behind us. We all have regret. We all have acted foolishly and in dumb ways before because of our anger, because of our loneliness, because of our being afraid. I encourage you today, as we walk out, we will never be the people that are affected for his name and his kingdom if we're walking around with guilt and shame and regret. I encourage you today, very simple, don't cross that line. Whatever you're feeling, whatever is causing you to feel, don't cross that line. It may be something that's in your head. Come up here today and pray about it. If you have crossed that line, come and ask for forgiveness. If you have never asked for forgiveness from Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, come today. Today is the day. Don't live another minute in regret. Don't live another minute because of shame and guilt. Don't let those three giants of anger, loneliness, and fear control your life anymore. Let the Lord Jesus Christ control it from here on. Father, we love you, we thank you, we praise you and honor you. Father, I don't know who it is today that needs to hear this message, but Father, I think all of us need to hear it in some way, and I know that there's somebody in here or out there today, Father. And today, Father, I pray, let them feel your peace, let them feel that comfort, experience you for who you are, and let that regret and that shame and guilt just be washed away by the blood of Jesus Christ. We love you, and we thank you, we praise and honor you, and it's in your Son's precious and holy name that we pray. Amen. Please stand.
82 in the row.
I love y'all. Have a great week. Stop me, please.
Heavenly Father, Lord, we just call upon your precious and holy name. Lord, we give you thanks, Lord, for everything, Lord. Father, we do ask, Lord, that you forgive us of our sins, Lord. And Lord, just take this message, Lord, and let us apply it to our hearts, Father. And just for everything we give you praise, Lord. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Have a great week.
Good job.